The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
Welcome to a Monday. It's a brand new week, and oh my God, it already feels like this is the week from hell. Interesting, you know, that new intro we have to the show, that's our friend Boca Brittany Summers, says regarding me, you know, she laughs with us, she cries with us. I'll tell you, it had been a while since I broke down, and I did this weekend. It is rough out there, and it's gonna get even more difficult as we edge closer to November 3rd. Election day. And I don't even want to think about what's going to happen between November 4th and January 20th, because the old phrase, hell on earth, is us. This is where we are. I went to a dark place this weekend, and I think I tweeted out something along the lines of, I don't usually tweet stuff like this, but if we don't get Donald Trump, if we don't vote him out on November 3rd, November 4th just might be my last birthday. And that's how I felt, because everything is just wrong. Everything is inside out and upside down. I coined the phrase, probably 10, 12 years ago, opposite world. It's when nothing makes sense. And it was true back then. It was true during the Bush administration. Things were upside down and insane. Dick Cheney, I mean, everything about that administration was nuts. But you look at them compared to what we've got today, and there's no comparison. I've often said, there is no bottom here. There is no basement. Just when you think you've gone as low as you can go, they dig three levels below. You know, when we were kids, used to joke about, we're going to dig all the way to China. We've already passed China. We're going to Alpha Centauri. We've dug through the planet, and we're off in another universe. We are in opposite world. There's nothing. Nothing is as it should be.
Everything you thought you knew, you never knew it all. Sideways is straight ahead. Facts no longer matter. Reality is now fiction. There's a signpost up ahead. Your next stop, opposite world.
Yeah. So I'll get to what had me so crazy this weekend. Maybe. You know, yesterday was a confluence, is that the right word, of events, of history and present coming back, and future, I suppose, too. Because August 30th, 2008, was the day I met my now husband. We went on a date. We met online, actually, and went out to dinner that night. And it was a pretty instant connection. So our first date was August 30th. It was that week was... I think the Saturday of Memorial Day weekend. And then, so that was the 30th. And 2 days later, the Tuesday of the following week, we actually went to see then vice presidential nominee Joe Biden speak. He was speaking at a local Democratic Party or club, Democratic Club meeting. And so David and I went. That was our second date. You know, 6.5 years later, I guess we got married. So that was August 30th, 2008. August 30th, 2016, just a few months before the 2016 election, I was in surgery, having most of my left lung removed for lung cancer. So that was August 30th, 4 years ago, yesterday. And then yesterday, it happened very quickly, but you know, my daughter, who turned 21 in quarantine, over the weekend or late last week, got a job offer, and it's a pretty decent sounding job offer, and she's been stressing over, you know, her savings dwindling. She hasn't worked since the middle of March, and you know, the thing that had her not looking for anything was that she lived with us and we're older. We are. And we're both high risk for COVID, you know, being down a lung. I don't have one to spare at this point. And long story short, the job is up in Palm Beach. So it's actually north of where Mar-a-Lago is. It's like northern Palm Beach, Palm Beach Gardens area. And long story short, she went up there, met with the guy on Saturday and accepted the job. And they're going to put her up for a while until, you know, they go through make sure it's a good fit for a month or so she doesn't have to rent a place. But the bottom line is, my baby left home last night. You know, and aside from a few weeks away at summer camp, the longest we've ever been apart is like a week. And now I'm an empty nester. So I guess it all, you know, all of these emotions came together this weekend. And while I'm watching the news and seeing the lying and the gaslighting from this administration and realizing that there is no turning back from here. I get these weird thoughts in my head, don't we all? Back to normal would be the name, a good name for a book, you know, if we somehow get Trump out of there, and it's going to be a long, hard fought battle to get back to some semblance of normal. But I keep thinking back to normal, good name for a movie. I don't know that we'll ever get back to normal because it's not only Trump. It's Trump. It's the coronavirus. It's the economy, stupid. I mean, I just read a news item that said the stock market, you know, today is the 31st. It closed out an hour or so ago. And it is the standard, the S&P 500, had its best August in over 30 years. And in this opposite world in which we live, Donald Trump looks upon that as the economy's great. It's the best economy ever. No, this is a return of the Gilded Age. This is that the haves, the very rich, are doing very well. Yeah, it is their best economy ever. And for the rest of us, well, we're fucked and not in a good way. The back and forth of it, the feeling of impending doom, hearing this poser pretending to be president who just it looks at it all as a joke. It's a game to him. It's a competition. It's a reality show. And we know that reality television has nothing to do with the real world. Reality in TV speak is not reality at all. No, it is opposite world.
Facts no longer matter. Reality is now fiction. There's a signpost up ahead. Your next stop, opposite world.
So, I had a rough night last night. And a rough night the night before. It's not been a good weekend. And then, I wake up this morning, and I thought, okay, there's a piece of good news here, something to celebrate. So after I did my what's new, so this news broke around 10:30, 11 o'clock, because I had gotten the recorded newscast done for the Progressive Voices Network when this story broke. And let me just read it to you. It says a federal appeals court has dealt a setback to former Trump White House advisor Michael Flynn by ruling that a district court judge can proceed with a planned hearing on the Justice Department's attempt to abandon a criminal case against Flynn. Now, you may remember, it was less than a month ago, a few weeks ago, the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals, a three-judge panel on that Court of Appeals, said that Judge Sullivan, I believe his name is, could not hold a hearing, could not appoint a retired judge, which he did to represent the people, basically, and fight against the Justice Department, saying, yeah, we know that Michael Flynn pleaded guilty, but we're going to let him withdraw that anyway, and we're going to drop the charges against him after he had already pled guilty. And Judge Sullivan said, no, 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 no. You can't tell me what to do. I'm a federal judge. And the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals, this is a three-judge panel. I'm calling for an en banc, I'm probably saying it wrong, hearing, meaning the entire panel of judges on the D.C. District Court of Appeals to rehear the case. So it's not just three judges who get to decide it, but it would be the full court, which is 10. And he won that. So the en banc hearing happened. And what happened is the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals sitting en banc voted 8-2 to reject Flynn's effort to dismiss the case immediately. So out of those 10 judges, that three-judge panel, the only two who voted yes to allow, you know, Michael Flynn to walk were those two who were voted yes on this panel. So what Flynn pleaded guilty in 2017 to a false statement charge brought by special counsel Robert Mueller, but was seeking to back out of the plea when Attorney General Bill Barr moved in March to drop the whole case. Thankfully, Judge Emmett Sullivan said, no, that's not how this works. They went before the three-judge panel who ruled erroneously, and the judge said, we want a rehearing of the entire panel, did it, and the entire panel, other than the two who were part of the three voting the wrong way, the rest of them said, hell no, he can't dismiss that case. Hell no, he's not going to walk. This guy pleaded guilty. So there's that. Michael Flynn does not just get to back out of his guilty plea. So thank goodness for small miracles. Because about an hour or two ago, this comes down the wires, as they say. And I'm just going to read it to you. Of course, I'll have to chime in with my commentary, but rather than try to paraphrase, quote, a divided federal appeals court panel, by the way, this would be this another three-judge panel from the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals, the same court that did this with Flynn, that found that that decided 2-1 that Flynn should be able to just take back, take back his guilty plea before they went on bank and the whole panel heard it. That, so it happened again. It's all just a little bit of history repeating. A divided federal appeals court panel dealt a severe blow to the U.S. House of Representatives' investigative power today, ruling, I hope you're sitting down for this one, that the House of Representatives cannot go to court to enforce subpoenas because there is no statute giving that chamber the authority to do so. I'm looking. I usually have a copy of the Constitution sitting here somewhere. I've got a bunch of them here. It's just not right here on my fingertips right now. The authority for Congress to perform oversight on the executive branch is in the Constitution. That's the authority, damn it. But again, it was a 2-1 ruling, marking the second time a D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals panel voided a subpoena the House issued last year to Don McGahn. Don McGahn, the former White House counsel, that the subpoena was for McGahn to testify about his dealings with Donald Trump related to the investigation into the alleged ties between the Trump campaign and Russia. The panel said Congress is free to pass a law making House subpoenas enforceable, but the courts can't create a legal mechanism to mandate compliance in the meantime. What are you talking about? There's inherent contempt. And this is what I was saying back when they were refusing to honor the subpoenas. Get the damn sergeant at arms or whoever is the appropriate person, send them out with an arrest warrant and arrest their asses or fine them an inordinate amount of money. They have that authority. But this three-judge panel from the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals said they don't. Now, the House, Nancy Pelosi, said the House will immediately appeal this ruling and seek a full, en banc, rehearing by the full Court of Appeals. But, oh my God, we are living an opposite world. This is frightening. It's not only opposite world. This is fascism. This is you know, God, we screamed while George W. Bush was in office about the idea of the unitary executive because they wanted to give the sitting president more and more power, the unitary executive. And we fought back against that. The thing that the Democrats did that was so wrong, that was political malpractice, was not fixing things, was not fixing the electoral college problem after George W. Bush stole the White House in 2000, losing the popular vote. Let's not even talk about Florida, because he probably lost the electoral college as well, if not for his brother Jebby, who was governor at the time, who helped steal the election for him. This is what Republicans do. They lie, cheat, and steal. And they gaslight. Everything this administration is doing is lying. Just today, Steve Scalise got scolded because he altered the words of Audie Barkin, the healthcare activist who's dying of ALS, who they took a video that aired, I think, at the DNC, and they edited his words. And Audie Barkin finally posted something on Twitter calling Steve Scalise out to shame him into removing that video, which he finally did. And then today, Joe Biden spoke, and what did the Trump people do? Immediately put out a false, explanation. What they altered his words. They lie. They're putting out deep fake videos. They are doing everything possible to try to steal this election. And you know what? The polls are tightening. Yes, I'm bitter. Yes, I'm scared. I am fucking scared out of my mind. And I'll say it again. If Donald Trump somehow manages to steal this election on November 3rd, I think November 4th will be my last birthday. And I'm not saying I'll do anything to myself. I just can't imagine living under four more years of this tyranny, because it is not a democracy. What little shred of democracy is left will be gone, because this man is a full-on fascist. So then I thought, okay, well, maybe we can leave. You know, say I had $5 in the bank and could actually scrape together enough money for, you know, a few airline tickets to get the hell out of here. Where could we go? The world is closed to us because this moron, this orange idiot occupying the Oval Office, doesn't know what the fuck he's doing. You know what their strategy is now? Herd immunity. Let's let everybody get it. That's the only way everybody's going to get it eventually anyway. Let everybody get it. And, you know, so Sweden, they're following the Swedish model. One of the only countries with a higher per capita death rate than the United States. That's their strategy now. That's what they said when they were asked why at the night of Thursday night, when Trump did his whatever that somnambulant speech was on the south lawn of the White House. When they were asked, a White House official was asked, why are you not social distancing? Why are people not wearing masks? A senior White House official said, because everyone's going to get it eventually anyway. Let me tell you something. I live in South Florida. When I moved back here after, you know, I grew up down here, born in New York, grew up down here, left after college, went back to New York, then moved out to LA where I spent the bulk of my professional career. When I moved back here, and when George Bush got elected, I thought I got to do something. So I found a group. I think back then it was like meetup.com. It was before Facebook. It was before any of that stuff. But there was like a meetup thing. And I said, all right, I'm going to go to a meeting. And I went to a meeting in North Miami Beach. And it was the home of a man named Jack Lieberman. And over the years, I had come to know Jack Lieberman. He wasn't a great friend. He was an acquaintance, but he was always there. Jack Lieberman ran a company called Progressive Rags. And he sold, I'm sorry, Jack Lieberman died yesterday of COVID. He sold t-shirts, you know, and buttons and progressive swag and bumper stickers and things like that. And Jack Lieberman was a fixture here in South Florida. Any political event I ever went to, if I'd look around and know nobody, and oh boy, there's Jack. I went to a, you know, I did a remote broadcast one year from a, I don't know, Veterans Against the War convention in Miami. There's Jack Lieberman at a table a few tables down from where I'm broadcasting, selling T-shirts and swag. Jack Lieberman had, you know, those Bernie house meetings, everything, opened his house, his home, his family, everything to the cause. He was a PDA member. He was a great guy. And a couple of months ago, I heard that he caught COVID and he was in the hospital. And I would hear updates about him on Facebook and that he was on a ventilator, and his wife Marilyn was as well. And for a while there, it looked like he was getting better. And then yesterday I saw that he died. It's just not fair. It's not okay. We shouldn't be in this mess. This is the United States of America. American exceptionalism. We're the best at everything. We're number one, damn it. You know what we're number one at? Infections. 6 million infections. How many dead? I don't know. I've got it here. But, you know, the numbers just keep rising and rising and rising. More than 25 million people have been infected with coronavirus worldwide. And here in the U.S., we passed 6 million. We have 4% of the world's population and about 25% of the world's deaths. It's disgusting. And it's all because of the malpractice by this president. So anyway, I'm thinking, if I could leave, where could we go? Nobody, you can't go anywhere. My friend Deborah, you know Deborah Liprit, Deborah, who does the Florida Man segments with me. Maybe we need to do that one of these days, except there's nothing funny about it anymore. She and her husband bought a home. They have a summer home in Ontario, I believe, in Canada. They can't go there. They're paying a fortune in taxes and upkeep for this house that they were planning on spending the summer at, and they haven't been able to go. So I decided to look up where could I go if I had the money to escape this godforsaken place, which it is as it's Trump's America. And I found the list. You want to know who in the world is open to U.S. citizens? Get your passport ready. You're ready? In alphabetical order. Albania. Belarus. There's a democracy for you these days. Brazil. One of the places with a worse outbreak than we have. Dominican Republic, because, of course. Kosovo. Maldives, which is, I think, underwater by now. Mexico, because they're our new best friends and they're paying for the wall, you know. North Macedonia. Serbia. Tunisia and Turkey. Thank you very much. Take your choice, ladies and gentlemen. Where do you want to live? Albania, Belarus, Brazil, Dominican Republic, Kosovo, Maldives, Mexico, North Macedonia, Serbia, Tunisia, or Turkey? I'm beyond words. I really am. I don't know where to go with this anymore. You have Donald Trump defending a murderer, and seriously, today, Kayleigh McEnany, the White House press secretary, was asked if Donald Trump would weigh in on the 17-year-old murderer who went from his home in Illinois to Kenosha, Wisconsin, with an AR-15. His mommy drove him there. They're claiming he shot in self-defense. He murdered two people and blew off the arm of the third. The first person he shot in the back. There was no self-defense there at all. And, oh, yes, everybody, you know, has their mommy drive them across state lines with an AR-15 so they could go defend themselves. Right. So here's the question. Kayleigh McEnany was asked.
Does the president condemn the actions of Kyle Rittenhouse, who is accused of shooting some of the protesters?
The president is not going to, again, weigh in on that. You can ask him this evening. He may weigh in further, but at the moment, he's not weighing into that.
Yeah. What? He is not weighing into that? Are you fucking kidding me? So Joe Biden delivered a speech today. Here's a little bit of what Joe Biden said. Here we go.
Here we go.
Whoops. Here we go.
I want to make it absolutely clear, something very clear about all of this. Rioting is not protesting. Looting is not protesting. Setting fires is not protesting. None of this is protesting. It's lawlessness, plain and simple. And those who do it should be prosecuted. Violence will not bring change. It'll only bring destruction. It's wrong in every way. It divides instead of unites. Destroys businesses, only hurts the working families that serve the community. It makes things worse across the board, not better. No, it's not what Dr. King or John Lewis taught, and it must end. Fires are burning, and we have a president who fans the flames rather than fighting the flames. But we must not burn. We have to build. This president long ago forfeited any moral leadership in this country. He can't stop the violence because for years he's fomented it. You know, he may believe mouthing the words law and order makes him strong, but his failure to call on his own supporters to stop acting as an armed militia in this country shows how weak he is. Does anyone believe there'll be less violence in America if Donald Trump is reelected? We need justice in America. We need safety in America. We're facing multiple crises. Crises under Donald Trump have kept multiplying. COVID, economic devastation, unwarranted police violence, emboldened white nationalists, a reckoning on race, declining faith in the birth and of the right American future. There's no reason why we can't just do so much more than we're doing. The common thread, the incumbent president who makes things worse, not better, an incumbent president who sows chaos rather than providing order, an incumbent president who fails in the basic duty of the job, which is to advance the truth that all of us know, that we're all born with the right to life, liberty. I want to make it absolutely clear.
He was saying it was the life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, and that's where the video got cut off. Okay. Okay. I hear it was a great speech until he said, Donald Trump says I'm going to stop fracking. I will not do away with fracking. Okay. The polls are tightening. Biden is only up by 3 points in Florida. And in Michigan, Trump is ahead in the latest poll. I can't even think of a tomorrow that has Donald Trump winning a second term. And winning is the wrong word, stealing, because that's the only way he'll get it. Yet he says the only way Joe Biden will win is if he steals the election. It's projection. It is pure projection. It's gaslighting. It's lying about every single thing. And this is why I went nuts this weekend. And this is why I'm having a hard time keeping my shit together. So, tell you what, I could use something funny. And we do have a guest coming up. For those of you who've been around since the Air America days, you know of Laura Flanders. Well, Laura Flanders, who I first met back in those Air America days, has been plugging away all these years, doing GritTV, and now her show is about to go syndicated nationally through PBS. So we'll talk with Laura Flanders in just a couple of minutes on the Nicole Sandler Show. We'll take a quick time out, and we'll be right back. Don't go away. If you can stand it, so much fun on the way. Here we go. All right. And while Progressive Voices is in a commercial, we can get some funny taken care of. This is a group of drag queens, and they call themselves, hold on, I want to get it right. I don't want to screw it up. They call themselves Kinsey Six, KinseySickS. And you can sing along if you like, because we're all thinking about tomorrow.
Doom.
This scum must be out tomorrow. Stephen Miller, Jared, and Gavaro. You're so done We're sinking from Trump's bizarro Putin white power and hydroxychloro. Bye bye Hun.
Are we stuck in dismay? Decay, a phony. We're so tired of these winds and spins. Oy vey. So
this bum must be out tomorrow. Work our asses off until tomorrow's voting day. He's fucked up so far. We don't need a pharaoh, so let's vote doomsday away.
He's a fucking buffet of cray and holy, so take his orange skin and kin away.
So you can't harangue our past tomorrow. Cause today, stone drunks at a bar know the skunk that you are, so just get out and stay away.
Just get out and stay.
Progressive Voices Network and NicoleSandler.com.
All right. See, that helped. It's a little palate cleanser from Kinsey Six. Tomorrow, a great take. Drag queen singing Vote Him Out Tomorrow. What more could you ask for? All right. And I don't know. That's not necessarily the right intro for our guest today, but hey, it's what I got. Hold on. I'm making sure. Oh, I did have her picture here. Oh, shoot. And I just got rid of the... Okay. Laura Flanders is with us. Laura, I'm going to bring you in without having your video up because I screwed up and I got rid of the... I got rid of your picture, I think, instead of... I don't know.
Oh, that's
I'm a
tragic.
Messier. I know. Believe me.
I can see you. You can't see me.
You can't see.
Where is the even-handedness?
I know. I'll work on it. I'm the queen of the multitask. In case you didn't know. So I will have you up on our video in just a moment. But in the meantime, I can say Laura Flanders is our guest, and we did meet at some point. We worked at Air America Radio at the same time, but I was doing my thing from down here in Florida and you were up in New York, and so I think we met at a Netroots Nation maybe, but regardless, I feel like I know you because we sort of worked together years ago.
Absolutely. I mean, I think Air America just did not want to see the two of us in the same place at the same time, because who knows what might have happened.
That's right. That's right. And now we have your picture there on the, there you are. So Laura Flanders is with us. You've been plugging away all these years, as have I. You with a bit more success. You had GritTV going on, and now the Laura Flanders Show. And this weekend, if I have my notes correct, you make the move to a nationally syndicated show via PBS.
Yeah, can you believe it? We premiere on public television stations this Sunday the 6th. So I guess it's not this Sunday, but this Sunday. I've got to get my head straight.
We
premiere this Sunday. September 6th, 11:30 a.m. on the World Channel, and then on about 97 other public television stations throughout the week. So yeah, you're right, Nicole. I've been plugging away forever. You know me. My brand is fairly upbeat. Doable systemic change models of what we can actually do to shift power in this country and the worlds of arts, politics, and economics. We call it the solutions of tomorrow today. And it's not just pie in the sky. It's real life stuff that people are doing around the country. And I don't think it's any surprise that public television stations are picking up on this programming this week, because this is a season that is desperately in need of really viable, positive alternatives. We're going to be airing a series of 26 shows that I think will leave people a little bit further away from despair than they are right this moment. Let's put it that way.
Well, I hope so. because honestly, my first half hour was filled with despair, just in case you were wondering. I had a rough weekend. You know, a friend died yesterday of COVID.
Yeah.
You know, a fixture, a South Florida activist, a guy who I've known as long as I've been down here, who has been there for every progressive event, movement, and it took him yesterday, Jack Lieberman, and it's a real loss for South Florida and the progressive community. And on top of that, it's opposite world. The theme of today is opposite world, because we have an administration who just is masters at the art of gaslighting. They tell us that the sky is green, up is down, in is out, and people, for some reason, are going along with this. They're celebrating a 17-year-old who had his mommy drive him from one state to another with an AR-15 so he could, quote, defend himself and kill two people. I just, nothing makes sense. And
I completely hear you, Nicole, and I'm so sorry for your loss and for everybody in South Florida's loss. I mean, this is the moment that we're in. Every time I come on one of these shows, Nicole, I feel like we should start with a little moment of breath.
Right.
Let's just try to be sane for a moment, because we are living in this period of sanity. I mean, we have a president in the middle of a plague, a race war engineered out of the White House, an economy the worst of which we've ever seen in history, heads to Florida. I think it was Florida where he was golfing this weekend.
Yeah.
What was that, his 500th visit to one of his businesses, his 251st golf game? I mean, does anybody remember him promising that he wasn't going to be having any time to play golf?
Right.
I mean, this is so hard.
And he brags that he's not going to take a salary, but the amount of money he spent on these golf outings and the way he's gouged the American taxpayer by jacking up the costs for rooms at his properties and golf cart rentals for Secret Service. He's nickel and diming us to death.
And while we're talking price, I mean, look at those Secret Service agents that he is directly exposing to COVID all across the country, whether it's Tulsa or at the conventions. You've got two down. Is it four down now tested positive for COVID? I mean, these are people putting their lives on their line. These are public servants.
Yep.
And, you know, how do we even talk about 180,000 dead and the continuing numbness that I think we're in when it comes to Black life in this country?
Because
this was another weekend of, you know, huge hits, whether you're talking Chadwick Boseman or what's happening in Kenosha, huge hits when it comes to the moment of possibility that we're in. I mean, I think about the 28th, right? Where you had this Black convention, you had a massive march on Washington on the anniversary of the March on Washington, which was on the day of the Emmett Till killing.
That's right.
That was why the day was originally picked.
Yep.
And at the end of that day of celebration of Black power and potential and mobilization and moving beyond and realizing a dream and fight and spirit and alternatives, you have this news about Boseman. And I think for a lot of people, this weekend has been like that. It's like Wakanda versus where we actually are.
Right.
You know, a society that is not racist, that is not sexist, that is not militarist, that was never colonized, versus where we actually are.
Yep.
And I just, not to shamelessly plug my show, but I do think that spirit of possibility that Wakanda spoke to in Black Panther, that alternative reality that people saw on the screen that isn't yet in their lives. What we try to do on our show is to say elements of this are in our lives at this moment. If we just look closely, if our media covered what is happening in this country and internationally, there are seeds of an alternative society that we could be living in right now. If we organize our workplaces differently, our banking differently, our farming differently, but not if we did, but we are. The people are doing this differently right now. And if we could put some power behind those models, none of this is preordained. We're not living at the behest of, you know, weather patterns overall.
we can make
choices that do things differently at this level of life on Earth.
Right. Except when one side, it's like, you know, I used to say, I'll debate a right winger anytime. But what I can't do is debate somebody who won't see the facts, won't agree, yeah. You know, say, okay, we agree on this. This is fact. The earth is round. The sky is blue, because we're dealing with people who have an alternate reality. They make shit up on a daily basis. I mean, it started with Fox years ago. I have a you're a radio person. You'll appreciate this. I made this years ago thinking, you know, maybe they'll buy it from me.
Your original source for fake news. Fox News. We make shit up.
Oh, no, fake news. He got it from you.
We make shit up. And, you know, they never took me up on it, but they followed the practice, and they still do. You got a president who says any news coverage that's not complimentary of him is fake. He doesn't read, but he lives by the authoritarian handbook. It's really frightening. And, you know, when I look at how he's mishandled this pandemic, another thing that got me over the weekend is my daughter, who turned 21 in this pandemic, you know, was home with me and my husband. And she left last night to take a job and move away, because I'm not going to be able to see her for a while. Someone just sent me a New York Times article, how to hug during a pandemic. We are living in such weird times that I frankly worry that I don't know how we're going to survive. So I play these funny little comedy bits, like you heard the version of tomorrow, right? I try to do one each day, because I say we need to get some laughs built up before we go insane. So how do you keep a positive attitude on your show?
I mean, well, so for example, you know, I've been sitting in this little cabin, if you can see the video.
It's beautiful.
I'm in this little cabin in upstate New York.
Yeah.
Yeah, it will be beautiful as we try to keep it warm during the winter, where we seem like we're going to be here too. But, you know, as we saw the pandemic play out in this community, it began to feel pretty scary, because even though the numbers are small, the population is very small, incidence was quite high. Because we have poultry plants and dairy plants and factories where workers were not going to be looked up. We're not being looked after. We're not even being told there was a pandemic. We're certainly not being given masks.
Right.
What happened then was that the community came together. And that's the story that we tell of how the food hub and the local politicians and the local media made a difference and got supplies to those people in ways that, if you look at it closely, could be built upon to change some supply systems going forward. So again, it's like, you want to talk about how Fox came about and how we ended up in a society where people are divided between MSNBC watchers and Fox News watchers, and there's no political education in between that would help people discern falsehood from fact. Well, we made decisions to do away with the limitations on how many companies an individual media conglomerate could own.
Absolutely.
We embraced the monopolies.
And by the way, that was Bill Clinton. Thank you very much.
That's right, 1996.
Yep.
And we basically stopped investing in political education and public education, and we stopped allowing unions to be able to educate people, and we stopped celebrating mass movements, if we ever did. We never brought them onto the media. Those were the ways that we insulated ourselves from the lies and the falsehoods. That was the way we maintained some glue in society, that we were all basically operating off one set of facts playbook. I mean, again, and if you peel back the onion or follow back the policy decisions, again, this stuff didn't just descend on us out of the heavens because we suddenly gave birth to a generation of people who loved Donald Trump. No, we changed media policy. And if I have one beef, and I don't, of course, have just one beef with Joe Biden, but the word media does never appear in his platform. It isn't in the agenda. So if he doesn't get it, that media diversity and media is inherently, I mean, it is at the heart of his problems that he's facing right now, and we are, and I'm voting for the guy.
Right, me too.
Then we're in hard shape, because many of us have been making the case for a very long time that if we don't understand the media battle here, you're not even going to get to first base, and that's what we're up against, and that's why it's so great, Nicole, that your show is still going on. And I feel very proud that independent media project like mine can go from years in the wilderness to getting on, you know, 200 public television stations.
And that's so encouraging. I mean, look, I've been plugging away. And frankly, I've worked in radio since college. I've been in radio for 40 plus years, 41 years now. And the industry has so changed. And again, back to Bill Clinton's Telecommunications Act of 1996, where before that, when I was a kid, a youngin in radio, you know, one company could own one AM, one FM, one TV in a market with a maximum of seven of each around the country. And
that's right.
And it led to a diversity of voices. And then consolidation happened. The Telecommunications Act went through. Clear Channel gobbled up 1,200 stations. I think they now own something like 800. And these big companies, it was Clear Channel, Cumulus, and I want to say CBS, but they were the C companies, and they really destroyed radio. And to the point where, you know, the job that one person used to do is now an eighth of a job. They'll have one person program eight radio stations. It's insane. And it's so, this is how everything is going, though.
No, absolutely. And what did we learn in this moment? I mean, again, going back to this little community here, they weren't hearing the news of what was happening here on the national networks or on cable news. If we hadn't had a local community radio station, our local health officer would never have been able to communicate to the people in this county. This is little Sullivan County, just 100 miles out of away from Wall Street. You know, wouldn't have been able to communicate to people what was happening here.
And there are many small towns around the country who have that problem. There have been events like on a weekend, a big news event, and some of these small market, they never got any of that news until Monday when there were live bodies back in the building.
Yeah. So we've really learned how valuable that local media is. And I will say on our show and others, you know, on our show, I was going to say on others like it, but there just aren't that many. But on our show, we talk about communities like in New Jersey, where we're looking at statewide funding for local media diversity, for media support of media co-ops, for investing in reporting that is, as it were, kind of determined by local communities. I think the people are going to, I mean, the one route out of this crisis that we're in, worst economy ever, most unemployed people ever on record, plague. The worst scenario is the scenario we talk about all the time, the Trump scenario, the dystopian nightmare. The other scenario is we do come out of this moment saying, actually, we have to make some different decisions. And if we don't want our entire economy to become Amazon land, we have to invest in small businesses in our community. We have to invest in perhaps land trusts to preserve local affordable housing and commercial real estate. We have to invest locally so that there are some local businesses available for us on the other side of this crisis to be here to serve us when we need them. I think people, you know, whether you're talking education, healthcare, you know, all the things that we talk about, media, it's important to look at the lessons that are coming out of this moment that have to do with change, not just going back to the way things were. Because we need a message of change coming out of this, and not just change in the White House, although that first absolutely, and the Senate.
Yes, and that's what has me so frightened right now. It is now August 31st, so we're just over 2 months away from Election Day, and I just see the tensions building, and I really worry. I didn't have distrust in our electoral system too much, other than problems with the touchscreen voting machines and, you know, not having hand counted paper ballots. But now there's a whole other threat level from this administration, who's doing everything possible to keep you from voting, trying to tell you that voting by mail is fraudulent. There's no, we've got this liar who will stop at nothing to win, and he's got the backing of not only the people that surround him in this administration, including a complicit attorney general that scares the daylights out of me, but now the courts. So I'm sure you heard the news today that I'm apoplectic over this. The same a three-judge panel from the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals said that the House of Representatives doesn't have subpoena power over Don McGahn, over the executive branch. What? It's in the Constitution, but they said they don't have the authority to do so?
Yeah, I mean, it's absolutely important that people read this decision. I mean, there is also an important dissent that says actually that it is there and there is a case. But it goes back to, I mean, the case that the majority is making, and this is going to be appealed. Nancy Pelosi's already said
immediately.
She's appealing.
Yeah.
but it probably won't get resolved till after the election. I mean, just to back up, I mean, this is the guy, Don McGahn, former general counsel, the guy responsible for the conservative justices getting appointed all across the country. He was the major source on the Mueller report. They say he is the most important witness because he witnessed the most. He was there the most. And he says he left. I mean, this was the tip of the iceberg, according to the New York Times reporter. He left on the day or because of the decision of Trump to offer a clemency to a woman in prison that Kim Kardashian had asked for. It's like, if that was the,
I remember that.
That's probably the one right thing he did, you know, maybe for the wrong reason. But anyway, I mean, it goes back to the importance of Congress also and the Senate, because we have got to be able to assert our rights in Congress, and not we can't just rely on the courts here, because then they're obviously not going to move in a way that is going to benefit this administration in the time we need. We've got to have power in Washington.
And I always, you would go back to our system of checks and balances. It's like, okay, so Trump, for some ridiculous reason, this country elected this reality TV show guy, and reality in reality TV show parlance means nothing about it is real. And he's a fake billionaire. He's failed at every business he's ever had. And yet there are a lot of very gullible people in this country who buy that. Maybe it's the aspirational thing. Ooh, I want to be like him one day. For whatever reason, they're buying his con. And so, but I thought it's okay, because we have a system of checks and balances. And even as reprehensible as so many of these Republicans are, they're not going to let him destroy the Republic. Well, famous last words, because they're bending over and letting him run roughshod over the Constitution. And I just sit here in disbelief. I cannot believe what's going on. So I love all your, you know, the positive thinking. I wish I had that in me. I joke, my name is Nicole, but sometimes I put a CY in front and I'm cynical. And that's where I am right now.
Maybe I can cheer you up. Please. Maybe you've heard her barking, but I'm going to show you a picture of my dog, and that would cheer you up.
Yes, absolutely. Okay, I heard her. Let's see who she is. Jackson wasn't here.
She's got to cheer you up a little bit.
What
that's
is she?
Trisha. She's a little mud. Patricia.
Oh my God, she's adorable.
Something or other. There she is. Whatever it takes to cheer you up at this point. But again, I mean, we have a crisis that requires that we have a majority in Congress, House and Senate, as well as the White House. If you look at that decision, it's all about the inability to get the legal powers required to put. Basically, they're punishing the House for not getting through impeachment. Because if we had gotten impeachment, then this would all have been a legal matter. They would have been able to issue subpoenas.
But here's the thing that's so frustrating, is we impeached him. He's impeached, but he doesn't accept it. And I think the Democrats screwed up by going so narrow. They could have thrown everything at him and one of them could have stuck, but they didn't. They went narrow, and I could second guess them all day. I did it. I first guessed them. I criticized them in advance because I had a feeling it would come out like this. So now he plays like he's vindicated. They found him not guilty because he twists everything because he's a sociopath. I mean, everything about this man is offensive. And I here we are sitting, feeling kind of helpless, hoping that common sense wins out in November.
Except that we're not, Nicole. I mean, I look at it and I say, yes, social distance. People are dealing with preserving their health and looking after their health. But at the same time, I mean, I think about the demonstration that took place in New York this summer, right? In the middle of this pandemic, in the huge crisis of health, while you have the statistics out about the economy, you have this demonstration for Black trans life, right?
Yep.
In the middle of New York City, in Brooklyn, and the aerial photographs saw thousands, 20,000 people, they say, standing. And if you look at the pictures, they're all wearing white, the color that the trans community asked them to wear, and they're standing 6 feet apart from each other.
Right.
And to me, that is the image, like the March on Washington that we just saw, like the protests that we've been seeing around the country, like the postcard writing sessions that are happening all across the country. Those are the stories and the images that stick with me in this session, in this moment, because these are people who have every reason to stay home, who have every reason to be scared, who have a whole lot more reason than most of us to have no faith in this system, but are showing up in belief of public their free speech rights, the power of public motion, of social movements, and of still belief in our democracy. And if we give up on that now at this point, we're in big trouble. And then once we exert our right to vote, we have to exert our right to pressure those people we elect to commit to concrete changes like the ones we show on our show, not just not being Trump. They have to commit to the kind of 5-point plan, if you will, that people like the Next Systems Project and the Democracy Collaborative have put out there, saying if we want to retain anything in a way of a diverse local community economy, if we want to retain healthcare, make actual healthcare available to most people, we have got to do X, Y, and Z. And these are things you can do at the local level, at the city level, at the regional level, and yes, please, at the federal level. But we've got to get specific about what has to change as soon as we get this guy out of here.
Exactly. But the immediate concern is voting, is making sure everyone votes and does everything they need to do to vote. I love that the NBA is opening up their arenas all over the country for voting. My husband's I'm not a sports person, but he said, you know, so many people who would, you know, who've never been inside a, you know, an NBA arena may just want to go to experience that. They'll be able to set up machines and have them socially distanced enough. And actually, I just read something today that what they learned out of Wisconsin, when we were so worried that the voting would endanger lives, that there was very little spike in infections after the voting there. So that's encouraging. I just don't want anyone to give up, because we say it every time, but I think it's never been truer that this is the most important election in our lifetimes.
Yeah, and that's a great initiative and a great example. Sports stadiums have the resources, they have the transportation, people know where they are.
Yep.
Why not have them always be polling places?
Exactly.
Why not always?
Always.
You know, and actually staff them with people perhaps who aren't retired volunteers, because that's a whole other aspect of who we leave our elections in the hands of. How many resources we actually put into our elections, our voting, is a crying shame. And the NBA is really showing a different way and an exciting one. And I love that you see. I've infected you with my positivity, Nicole.
I try. I really do. And I try. I try. It's, you know, the cynical part of me. The cynical gets me every now and then. And I want to think positively, but I go to those dark places. For instance, I looked today to see where. If I had the money, and if for some reason Trump doesn't get out of here, do you know where in the world Americans can go right now? I have a list.
Very many places. Where?
Albania, Belarus, Brazil, Dominican Republic, Kosovo, the Maldives, Mexico, North Macedonia, Serbia, Tunisia, and Turkey.
Okay.
Yeah. That's the company we're in. So if you want to get into better company, vote this guy out. Make sure you vote for the down ballot Democrats. And I'll tell you what you want. You want encouraging. You want positivity. Here's what I'm really positive about. Marie Newman won her primary in Illinois. She beat Dan Lipinski, one of the worst so-called Democrats in Congress. Cori Bush won, beat out a dynastic family.
Yep.
The squad is expanding. Jamal Bowman. There are a number of real good progressives who are poised to win because they're in blue districts, because they primaried people who it was time for them to go. And I think that's a step in the right direction. So I'm excited about the new faces we're going to see in Congress
Downstate ballots, all important. Those downstate elections, all important. Those are the people that will actually make change where you live.
So important. So again, Laura Flanders, it's not Grit TV anymore. It's the Laura Flanders Show. Your new Twitter handle is the LF Show. Find you at lauraflanders.org. And again, starting this Sunday morning, tell us again where we can see you.
It is 11:30 a.m. Eastern on the World Channel. You can get all the information about that screening, plus all the additional PBS stations that are playing our show, either at their listings or at our website, lauraflanders.org. Go to lauraflanders.org. follow us on social media, celebrate some of the really power-shifting initiatives happening in your own backyard, and find out how you can get involved.
And get a taste of the positive outlook as well. Get some positive energy going. Laura Flanders, it's a pleasure to talk to you. Thank you so much.
You it was really too, nice Nicole. Keep up the great fight.
Thanks so much. You as well. I look forward to seeing your show. Take care. Bye-bye. All right, Laura Flanders, everybody. That was fun. And she got me cheered up. Yeah, see, I didn't end the show in tears. That's a good thing. Tomorrow, it's Tuesday. Gotta Laugh will be here. And, oh, it's the Massachusetts primary. Massachusetts, vote out Richie Neal. I forget his opponent's name. Excuse me, but Richie Neal, no, the other guy is who you want, the other Democrat. And go Ed Markey. All right, thanks for listening, everyone. I'll see you tomorrow. Be good and be good to yourself. That's advice I need to take too, I know. All right, see you tomorrow.